I can do this all day.
Oh!
Hello, everybody. My name is James, and I am the poor boy, and welcome to NostalgiAttack, where I review old films from my and your childhoods. What happened to American patriotism? If you aren't in the country, it might seem like people couldn't care less about our country and its guarantees. As little as 10 years ago, people loved our great country and understood just what our founding fathers fought for us to have. Try saying that 5 times fast. Now it seems like the enemy is right at our front door, claiming our freedoms are evil. I'm a very patriotic guy. I love my country. I respect our founding fathers. And I am grateful those great men made sure our rights were the foundation of our nation's existence. I've even come up with a few American superheroes for my own little universe. Notice anything familiar? Yep. Like most modern nation-based heroes, Patriot was inspired by Captain America. During the rise of World War II, the American populace was growing increasingly concerned with the fighting abroad. American Nazis were marching and meeting in the streets. Hitler was on the doorstep of every country, and Japan was pushing for invasion harder and harder. During this time, Martin Goodman, founder of little-known publisher Timely Comics, which would become Marvel Comics, saw the success of American superheroes like Superman, published by rival company National Comics, and wanted something to both compete with that and raise the American people's patriotism. Goodman hired Joe Simon and Jack Kirby to create a new hero to do that. Simon saw the rise in Nazism in the States and, being a Jew himself, wanted to fight back with the spirit of the nation that allowed him and his family to thrive. Simon would take the ideals and iconography of the country and create Steve Rogers, a good-natured weakling, given peak physical ability to fight for the innocent as Captain America, wielding a star-spangled shield based on Timely Comics' own logo, but was switched to the iconic circular shield when MLJ Comics pointed out it was too similar to their own character, the Shield. They kind of went all in on that, didn't they? Debuting in December of 1940, with Simon writing and Kirby drawing and finalizing designs, Captain America was a surprising hit, selling nearly 1 million copies each issue, and even being shipped out to soldiers in care packages as morale-boosting entertainment through the war. Originally, Cap was state-bound, basically a government-funded superhero fighting American branches of Nazism led by the Red Skull. This led the American-German Bund, a Nazi group, to threaten the company, and Goodman eventually had to hire security in case of attacks. Just kind of shows how powerful good is when evil is threatened by paper. Unfortunately, after the war, many heroes and comic books fell out of interest, and Captain America was canceled after 75 issues after struggling to keep the character afloat. Over the years, there were several attempts to bring back the character, but Captain America was a hero most associated with World War II. Unlike Batman or Green Hornet or Captain Marvel, Captain America was created almost as a propaganda piece, whereas the others were just heroes fighting crime in their own cities. They made it work, however, as the captain returned in the 60s with the explanation that he was frozen in Arctic waters during a mission and revived by the newly formed Avengers in 1964. This would be his continual fate through the decades, as with each revamping of the publications, Cap would be lost near the end of World War II and found frozen in whatever period the comics were currently published. But because of shifting political climates, Vietnam, the Cold War, and other reasons, Captain America was a rare character, and in the 70s was delegated to a comic based on his World War II exploits. In the 80s, the run was shaky, popular enough to continue publishing, but didn't warrant any big events. In the 90s, it was about the same, despite some rebranding. In the 2000s, Cap was killed off and replaced by Bucky, but was brought back a few years later. And even now, Captain America still isn't a big character in comics. The biggest boosts in popularity happened in film and TV. Captain America would make guest appearances in Marvel's animated series in the 80s and 90s, two terrible films in the 70s and one in the 90s, a lead role in a couple animated series, quite a few video games in both lead and side roles, and an MCU film that probably did more for the reputation of the character than the previous 70 years of material. The first Avenger is actually the first Marvel anything I was introduced to that stuck with me. It's still one of my favorite movies, and was one of the reasons I became a writer. Thanks to the success of Iron Man in 2008, Marvel Comics went from failing comic company to prosperous multimedia conglomerate. and began setting up a film series to expand their fandom. And it worked. After Iron Man 1 and 2, The Incredible Hulk, and Thor, interest was skyrocketing, and the first Avenger ended up being the most popular Marvel film at the time. It's still probably the best film in the MCU, in my opinion. For good reason, too. I see this movie as the actual start of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Iron Man, Hulk, and Thor seemed more like standalone films compared to First Avenger, which tries to connect all of them in simple ways. Howard Stark is behind a lot of the tech in the film, and even shows off early versions of Tony's flight tech. The Tesseract is an ancient Asgardian artifact, and it was hinted that Bruce Banner was part of the project trying to recreate the Super Soldier Serum in The Incredible Hulk. The most the other movies had was a random appearance of Coulson. So, grab your shield and let's watch Captain America: The First Avenger. The film opens in Norway, 1942. Johan Schmidt, played by Hugo Weaving, invades the city of Tunsberg, searching for the Tesseract, a powerful artifact, and finds it in an old church, hidden in a wooden mural. Cut to New York, Steve Rogers, played by Chris Evans, is trying to join the army, but his long list of ailments keep him from being accepted. So he goes to the movies to cheer up. This is good film direction, actually. The first newsreel played is one that talks about how everyone can help with the war, even if they can't fight, further cementing Steve's failure to help. The film is interrupted by a loudmouth, and Steve tells him to shut up and be respectful, only to get taken out behind the theater and beat up. Obvious foreshadowing is obvious, but creative. Steve is saved by Bucky Barnes, played by Sebastian Stan, who has come to invite Steve to one last double date before Bucky is shipped out. But Steve's date shows no interest in him as they look around a future tech expo. Steve is distracted by another recruitment office in the expo and tries to enlist once more despite Bucky warning him not to. Steve is caught, though, by Dr. Abraham Erskine, played by Stanley Tucci, who overheard Steve and Bucky's argument and is impressed by Steve's multiple attempts to enlist. Erskine gauges Steve with a single question.
Do you want to kill Nazis?
I don't want to kill anyone. I don't like bullies. I don't care where they're from.
And accepts Steve for a special military program. Soon, Steve is put through the ringer in boot camp, but proves his mettle by pushing through despite his ailments, impressing Agent Peggy Carter, played by Haley Atwell, several times. During training, Steve proves he is willing to put his life on the line to save others when Colonel Chester Phillips, played by Tommy Lee Jones, throws a dummy grenade to prove a point to Erskine.
He's still skinny.
The night before the procedure, Erskine and Steve talk, and Erskine explains just why Steve was chosen, citing Schmidt, who stole Erskine's prototype formula, wanting to become the Nazi Superman, but was severely changed in other ways. Steve was chosen because of his good nature, because of what makes the formula work.
Good becomes great. Bad becomes worse.
The next morning, Peggy escorts Steve to the lab location and learns why Steve doesn't run from a fight.
You start running, they'll never let you stop. You stand up, push back. Can't say no forever, right?
Soon, Steve is prepped for the operation, serum injected, and Howard Stark, played by Dominic Cooper, uses a special chamber to bombard Steve with Vita rays. After nearly blowing up the lab, the chamber opens, revealing Steve in peak physical condition. I actually like that peak physical condition isn't ridiculously buff and cut up. Too much muscle will put strain on your joints, and having some fat on your body is actually very good for you when muscular, as your body will use that to fuel the growth, even if you're eating enough to sustain it. Also, the less fat you have, the more joint and foot pain you'll have. As Steve is getting his bearings, Hydra agent Heinz Kruger, sent by Schmidt, steals the last vial of serum and kills Erskine before escaping. He meets with a getaway driver outside, but Peggy kills the driver and Kruger steals a cab and tries to run down Peggy. But Steve saves her before sprinting after the cab, using his knowledge of the city to his advantage, catching up to Kruger easily. Kruger tries shooting Steve, but ends up flipping the cab and takes a child hostage to keep Steve away. Kruger heads to the docks, where he dumps the child in the water, but the kid can swim, so Steve goes after Kruger's sub, easily capturing Kruger and tries to interrogate him. But...
Cut off one head. Two more shall take its place. Hail Hydra!
In Hydra headquarters, some of Hitler's top men are meeting with Schmidt, wondering just why his research division hasn't been meeting their weapons quota. So Schmidt shows them Dr. Armanzola's, played by Toby Jones, latest design, powered by the Tesseract, and kills the men once they find out Berlin is on Schmidt's map of targets. Back in America, because his blood is so valuable, Phillips has sidelined Steve. But a senator decides to use him for PR in a stage show. That leads to propaganda films, comics, and recruitment posters, all to sell war bonds. Eventually, Steve does enjoy his part in the show, but after a bad morale booster in Italy, realizes he's been dragged around as a dancing monkey, despite what he could do for the war. Meeting Peggy after the show, Steve learns that Bucky's division was sent to take a Hydra base, but few came back. And Steve goes to Phillips to learn Bucky's status, learning he might be dead. Phillips tells him that a rescue mission would be futile because of the location and security around the base. Steve takes a look at the map in Phillips' tent and sets out to save the soldiers, with a bit of help from Peggy. As it turns out, Peggy was able to get Stark to fly Steve over enemy lines to bypass the major security, allowing Steve to sneak into the base easier. Finding a factory in the base, Steve grabs some of the Tesseract batteries Zola had made for weaponry, then locates the prisoners, frees them, and goes to find Bucky as the prisoners steal weapons and tanks to escape. Schmidt sees the riot and sets the base to blow up before he and Zola go to escape. As Zola gathers his papers, Steve spots him as he looks for Bucky and investigates, finding Bucky strapped to a table. Steve frees him, and the two make their way through the facility. Before they can escape, Steve is confronted by Schmidt. The two throw a couple punches before Zola separates them, and Schmidt reveals what happened to him, trying to convince Steve they both left their humanity behind once they were injected before he leaves to escape, using a weird escape pod, and giving Zola the keys to his car, which, might I add, is a really cool car. It was actually designed specifically for the film to match Schmidt's personality and interests. Steve spots a possible escape route, and he and Bucky head upward. Bucky manages to get across the beam before it falls and refuses to go anywhere without Steve. So, Steve jumps the gap. The next morning, Phillips and Peggy believe Steve to be dead, only for Steve to appear on the edge of camp, leading the prisoners back safely. Steve surrenders for punishment, but Phillips dismisses him, and Bucky leads an applause for Steve's actions. Soon, in London, Steve marks down Hydra bases he spotted on a map while saving Bucky, and puts together a team. At a local pub, Steve recruits, this is a long one, Timothy Dum Dum Dugan, played by Neil McDonough, Gabe Jones, played by Derek Luke, Jim Morita, played by Kenneth Choi, James Montgomery Falsworth, played by J.J. Field, and Jacques Denier, played by Bruno Ritchie, alongside Bucky. Later, Steve meets with Stark, who shows him some new equipment, including some shields. But Steve is drawn to a simple circular shield, which Stark tries to talk Steve out of. Steve shows Peggy, who is a bit mad after an earlier incident, and just...
Yes, I think it works.
And while Stark is too shocked to refuse, Steve gives him some ideas for the costume. Cut to the Howling Commandos cutting through Hydra's defenses, taking their bases and destroying their tanks.
USA! 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 USA!
Hey. America comes before our petty squabbles. Soon, Steve leads a raid on a Hydra train after getting confirmation Zola is on board. But Steve and Bucky are attacked by a Hydra agent and a Masterman unit. The two take out the agent, but Masterman gets the upper hand and sends Bucky flying out of the train. Steve takes it out and goes after Bucky, who is holding onto a handrail for dear life. But the railing breaks before Steve can save him. The mission was a success, though, as the rest of the commandos have captured Zola. Phillips interrogates Zola and manages to get him to talk by convincing him Schmidt will kill him because he knows too much, and Zola isn't the type willing to die for a cause. After a briefing revealing Schmidt's plans and location, Steve has an idea on how to attack their remaining base. Soon, Steve is roaring through the forest, using a gadget-filled motorcycle to lose the Hydra agents and make his way into the base. Steve fights as long as he can, but is ultimately overwhelmed and taken to see Schmidt. Steve is able to distract Schmidt long enough for the rest of the commandos, along with Phillips' squadron, to break into the base. Schmidt escapes amid the chaos, and Steve goes after him. After a run-in with some of Phillips' men, Schmidt makes his way to the hangar and puts his plan into motion. Steve fights his way through the hangar trying to catch up to the plane, but fails, when Phillips and Peggy give Steve a ride in Schmidt's Roadster. I know this thing was specifically made to look Nazi, but I want this car. It's so cool. It even has a turbo booster. Once close enough, Steve jumps onto the plane, and Phillips narrowly keeps the car from falling over the edge of the runway. On the plane, Steve fights his way into the cockpit, only to be ambushed by Schmidt. Steve ends up launching Schmidt into the tesseract chamber, breaking it, and causing the tesseract to dislodge. Schmidt frantically grabs it, but is disintegrated by the power, leaving Steve to deal with the plane. Steve contacts base and reasons the only way he can fully stop the plane is to crash it in the ocean. As he does, he and Peggy make a date to go dancing when the radio loses contact. Soon, the war is won. The commandos toast to their friend. Stark tirelessly searches the depths for Steve, recovering the Tesseract. And Peggy finds a picture of small Steve as she organizes files. Steve is gone, but the world does not forget him. Steve wakes up in a hospital room and looks around, wondering where he is when a woman who looks a lot like Peggy enters. Steve is suspicious of his location, knowing he went to the baseball game that was playing on the radio. Two guards in black enter when Steve gets forceful, and Steve easily throws them through a wall and escapes. He exits the facility, shocked at the world around him. Several SUVs drive up, and Nick Fury, played by Samuel L. Jackson, tells Steve he's been frozen for 70 years. And that was Captain America: The First Avenger. This movie is awesome. It takes the skeleton origin and adds so much to it. The story itself is great. The music is perfect. The costumes are on point. It's what a historical film should be without being a historical film. The fact that Steve was in the right place at the right time adds to the origin. He wasn't sought out. There wasn't anything that made him stand out. Dr. Erskine just overheard a conversation and was like, "This kid sounds like a nice fellow. Let's get him in the program." The whole 40s sci-fi lab is a nice addition as well. I like the idea that Steve wasn't allowed into combat because he was the only recipient of the serum. If he died, that's it. No super army. A propaganda stage show was a clever way of introducing the idea of Captain America in-universe. And the fact that the costume is simple and made of era-accurate wool spandex instead of being over-designed and specially made material is good historical consistency. The soundtrack is amazing. Alan Silvestri just knocks it out of the park again and again. The score is very militaristic and patriotic, comprised mainly of brass instruments. And Captain America's theme sounds triumphant, but not bombastic. It's a quiet confidence. Star-Spangled Man with a Plan was written by Alan Menken of Disney Renaissance fame, and he captures the 1940s stage sound perfectly. Hang on, I'm gonna try something. Yeah, sounds like something you'd hear gathered around the radio after dinner. I am a little upset when Captain America throws his mighty shield wasn't in the film, though. Even as a reference, I'd be happy. Like, Bucky started teasing Steve about having a frisbee for a shield, and the commandos just come up with a short song on the spot. And it established their relationship further. The casting is incredible. And I honestly miss this accuracy of casting in comic book films. Chris Evans was a great Steve Rogers. He was believably awkward and nervous while he was scrawny. You could immediately understand Steve was pushed around most of his life, so tried not to stand out. But he still wanted to do the right thing. As the stage show goes on, Steve gets more confident, but not cocky. And as a soldier, Steve is calculating. He's willing to fight head-on, but he also knows when it's time to use a quieter approach. I would also like to point out that scrawny Steve wasn't just digitally shrunk. Evans had a body double in Leander Dini. To get the scenes right, Evans would perform the scene so the rest of the cast understood how he'd deliver the lines. Then Dini would come in, study the footage, and mimic Evans' movements almost exactly in the scene, say the lines so the cast would have someone to play off of, and later, Evans' head was painstakingly masked over Dini's. The result is fantastic. It never stands out. It blends together impeccably. The light and angles are all perfect. It just proves how good effects can be when given time, money, and people who love their job. Sebastian Stan was great as Bucky. I like that instead of making Bucky a random teenager that hangs around the army camp, he was the guy Steve grew up with. He kept Steve safe for the most part, but also let Steve make his own decisions, even if they could get him in trouble. He teases him, worries about him, and is willing to die for him. Stan and Evans' chemistry make their relationship believable, and it hits you almost as hard as it hits Steve once Bucky dies. Peggy Carter originally was a one-off love interest that later got an origin as a child soldier in the French Revolution who later joined S.H.I.E.L.D. Believe it or not, Sharon Carter, her niece, would be the more well-known character for a long time. But Hayley Atwell plays the revamped Peggy brilliantly. She is a soldier, but in 1940s war, she's not exactly treated as an equal, and tries to prove herself time and again, even nearly dying trying to stop Kruger. Aside from her appearance, the only time she has allowed herself to actually be feminine is with Steve. She is a combatant agent, trusted by Stark, Phillips, Steve, and eventually the Howling Commandos, and helps lead the charge into Schmidt's base. Stanley Tucci gives life to Dr. Abraham Erskine as a quiet genius. He doesn't try to stand out because of his past in Germany, but he is willing to work for the U.S. to stop the Nazis. The way he connects with Steve as the metaphorical little guy makes his eventual death harder, despite how little he was actually in the film. Dominic Cooper is a really good Howard Stark. It takes the Howard Stark shown in Iron Man and throws it out the window in favor of a more Robert Downey Jr. style portrayal, showing that Tony didn't get his persona from nowhere. Stark is a brilliant, egotistical, and flirtatious engineer, but he's got a soft side, tirelessly looking for Steve because, I think, he was the only person he could call a friend. Hugo Weaving is fantastic as Red Skull. He's imposing, he's calculating, he's intelligent, and that's what gives him that villain factor. He's always in control, and he knows it. The only time Schmidt gets angry is when every single plan has been foiled, and even then it's a controlled anger. Every other time something has gone wrong or threatened his plans, he's been more annoyed than anything. Schmidt's appearance was also a combination of practical and digital effects. Weaving wore a mask with the details of a skull, and was then digitally melded to fit Red Skull's appearance, sinking his eyes further in, making the cheekbones more prominent, and thinning the lips for a toothier mouth. Toby Jones brings Arnim Zola to life as a small, awkward genius. He can build any weapon Schmidt needs, but he isn't as dedicated to Hydra as everyone else seems to be, and turns tail as soon as he learns he will be killed because of his knowledge. All right, lightning round. Phillips shows up very little in comics, but Tommy Lee Jones makes him a memorable part of the film. Howling Commandos are nicely cast, each is recognizable, both in appearance and personality. Dugan is rowdy, but is a brilliant tactician. Jones is energetic and serves as the German-French translator. Marita is snarky and works as the communications man. Falsworth is calm and works as the group spy. And Dernier is excitable and supplies the explosives. Also, Neil McDonough pulls off Dum Dum Dugan's silly outfit from the comics very well. The designs are awesome. Hydra's weaponry is very German, but with an added touch of futuristic. Captain America's costume has the right amount of comic book design and militaristic detail. And alternatively, the stage version is simple and fits right with the 1940s laughably bad attempts at superhero costumes. The showgirl outfits are nice takes on actual showgirl costumes, combined with the American flag. And the additional military helmets later on in the show are cool, and I like that they reference Steve's ultimate design by giving him the A helmet in his Thrown Together uniform. The Thrown Together uniform actually inspired a lot of my designs, using regular everyday clothing to put together a costume. I think a lot of superheroes should have that kind of start to their costume, similar to New 52 Superman and Flash, or MCU Spider-Man. It grounds them a lot more. The shields are awesome, in design and ultimate use. They reference the original heater shield and make good use of it, and then give Steve the familiar circular shield in a better way than Eisenhower had it made as a gift. Making it a prototype for a failed bigger defense project was a good way to explain both the origin and the special properties of vibranium. The paint jobs are nice and clean, and the fact the circular shield has its paint job damaged through the movie is a nice detail that shows just because the shield is indestructible doesn't mean the paint is. That would be kind of a funny thing to add to the comics. Cap has to repaint the shield every few weeks until Tony just gives him some paint derived from the stuff he uses to color the armor. The only thing that I think was missing was that Sergeant Fury wasn't even so much as referenced in the film. How hard would it have been to get David Hasselhoff to reprise his role as the original Nick Fury? Or just have a file with his picture as a one-off gag when Phillips and Steve are putting together a team. Other than that, the movie was awesome. There need to be more period superhero films. Imagine if we got a classic 30s gangster-style Green Hornet film, or a 60s sci-fi Iron Man, or even a 50s Captain Marvel. Anyways, if you would like to see a war film about the patriotic origin to the most patriotic superhero, I recommend Captain America: The First Avenger. It is my belief that a lot of people in this world need Jesus, or at least need to read the Bible. So let me help you get started with a verse I think goes well with this film. 1 Peter 3:14 says, "But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened." This means that a man who does good simply because it is good will be rewarded, even if others punish or hate him for it. Do not fear a hateful man's disapproval, for that which gains their approval is either selfish or evil. Thank you everyone for tolerating my whims. Like the video if you enjoyed it, comment if you want to add something, or have any movies you want reviewed. Subscribe if you want to see more, and I hope to see you in the next video.